This is C-SPAN's America and the Courts. Next, oral argument from the Second Circuit Court of Appeals in New York City on Arar versus Ashcroft. Mayor Arar, a Canadian citizen, is challenging his rendition by the U.S. government to Syria, where he alleges he was tortured and released after 1 year without being charged. The argument was heard on Tuesday in an en banc session of the court, meaning all 12 appeals judges heard the case.
Please be seated. There's one case on calendar, Arar versus Ashcroft. City Council press is welcome. A couple of little items of business. Pursuant to 28 U.S.C. 46C1, I hereby designate and assign the Honorable Joseph M. McLaughlin, Senior Circuit Judge, to participate at his election as a member of the in-bank court, reviewing the decision of a panel of which he was a member. Judge Sotomayor is a member of the panel of this court, and she is out of town at the moment, but she will be participating by video, and we see her. Good afternoon. And finally, we're going to just pause a moment so that I think C-SPAN is here. They're going to get up to speed, and if there are any photographs to take, they should be taken now and be gotten out of the way. If so, we'll take you. Okay, at this time, we'll hear argument. Mr. Cole, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. May it please the court. The complaint in this case alleges that Maher Arar, a Canadian citizen on his way home to Canada, changing planes at JFK, was pulled out of line by federal officials, locked up for 2 weeks, denied access to counsel and the courts, and then sent in the middle of the night on a federally chartered jet to Syria, a country infamous for torture, where in fact he was tortured and locked up in a cell the size of a grave for a year. Having successfully kept Mr. Arar out of court while they had him in their custody, defendants now ask this court to deny any claim for relief because he did not pursue the very avenues of judicial redress that they blocked him from pursuing. That catch-22 cannot be and is not the law. To dismiss this case at the threshold would be to reward obstruction of justice and to deny protection of the most fundamental human right, the right not to be tortured. I will address first our Bivens claims with respect to torture and arbitrary detention, then our Bivens claims with respect to the denial of Mr. Arar's access to court, and third, our statutory claim that he was that defendant's actions violated the Torture Victim Protection Act. The Bivens claims for torture and arbitrary detention that we press here are not new claims. They are paradigmatic claims. Bivens has always been recognized as appropriate to remedy federal officials' abuse of people within their custody, Bivens itself.
Before you continue, it would be helpful, even before you get to Bivens, because it's part of the argument, if you'd explain to me, you talk good deal and more as the briefing goes on about access to counsel and access to courts. What isn't entirely clear to me is whether you are using that with respect to the availability of a Bivens action because no alternative was available, or whether it's part of your substantive due process claim, or whether it is, as you seem to advert to it, at least at one point, a completely separate, standalone, procedural due process, or does it work all three things at the same time?
I think it is all of the above, Your Honor. I think that what's critical about this case is the confluence of two things. One, an intentional conspiracy to subject an innocent man to torture, and two, an intentional conspiracy to keep him out of the courts, to deny him access to the very judicial redress that Congress specified was supposed to be provided. And that's relevant, Your Honor.
But you aren't conceding that even if he had access to those remedies, they would have been, in this circumstance, adequate, are you?
No, but I think it makes it a much easier case, Your Honor, when the government argues there are exclusive avenues for review, but it turns out that the government did everything it could to make sure that there was no way that he could pursue those avenues of review. It takes away that argument from the special factors analysis that would suggest that it's not appropriate to recognize a torture claim.
You mean by inviting counsel to a meeting by calling counsel's office at 4 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon, and then serving him with an order of removal when he was on the way to the plane to take him to Syria.
That's right. And if you look at the chronology, what happens is he's in detention for 10 days. They don't seem to be rushing. On Saturday afternoon, he sees a lawyer. Then they go into overdrive, and they suddenly call a special interview to start at 9 o'clock at night, leave a message on the lawyer's voicemail on a Sunday night. She's obviously not there.
At her office.
At her office. She's not there. They then have a six-hour session from 9 p.m. till 3 a.m. When does the federal government work? From 9 p.m. to 3 a.m. They then, the lawyer comes in and says, gets the voicemail, and she says, "Where's my client?" They lie to her and say that the client
Mr.
has been
Cole?
Sent to New Jersey.
Mr. Yes. Cole,
there's a question.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Yes.
All right. I understand your emphasis on the violation of the access to courts. But I'm not quite sure, and I think it was the question that Judge Sachs started with, which is absent having been able to stop his rendition to Syria, which obviously he would have liked that opportunity, that doesn't address, at least in my mind, whether or not that access to court claim is tied to the torture claim.
Right. Well,
do you lose if we accept the government's argument that the INA was his only mode of remedy?
Well, I don't think you can. I think because the government denied his ability to pursue that remedy, it would be absurd to say that the case should be dismissed.
Let's assume he had it. Let's assume, please, right, for the sake of argument, that he had gone before an administrative judge, an administrative judge had denied his application to stay his removal. He was removed and he was tortured in Syria. You uncover evidence that the torture was at the behest of the federal agents. Are you conceding then that you would have had no Bivens remedy or any other remedy?
No, not at all.
Merely because he had.
No,
well, that's the point. That's why I'm trying to figure out and untie your arguments
right,
a bit.
Right. Well,
all right.
Yes.
So let's assume the assumption, which is how does the access of court claim, if at all, tie to the substantive due process claim involving the torture?
Okay.
Or the conspiracy to torture.
Right. If there had been no denial of access to court, then we wouldn't have the independent access to court claim that I will talk about in a moment. So that would be different. But with respect to the claim for torture and arbitrary detention, had he been sent to Syria for that purpose, pursuant to an intentional conspiracy by the federal government to send him there, But they kept from him evidence of that conspiracy that he only learned of later. I think he would indeed still have a Bivens claim for torture.
I'm sorry, you say conspiracy, you mean within the federal government when
yes.
you use that term?
Conspiracy by the federal officials to take this man who Canada was willing to accept, who lived in Canada, and instead send him to Syria, a country that tortured.
Mr. Cole, what exactly was the cause of action that Mr. Arar was barred from bringing by the defendant's alleged interference with his right of access?
The cause of action was a CAT claim, Your Honor. And in fact, the district court said it. It said it on page 269 of the reported decision. Arar alleges that he was intentionally deprived of the opportunity to obtain adequate review of his CAT claim. And then further on, he says, defendants by their actions essentially rendered meaningful review of Arar's CAT claim impossible.
So does that mean you're not suggesting that he was precluded from challenging the decision to remove him? You're only complaining about his ability to challenge where he was removed to because of the possibility of torture?
Well, a CAT claim would be a challenge to the removal order on the grounds of torture.
I understand that, but there would also be a separate removal-type proceeding, which the government talks about in their brief. So again, I'm following up on Judge Cabranes and just want to know, what is the claim that your client says the defendants precluded him from bringing?
Right.
You've told us the CAT claim. Anything else?
It was he was precluded from seeking any review of his removal, including the CAT claim, including challenging the grounds for his removal in the first place. What we alleged was the CAT claim. He was precluded from pursuing the CAT claim. And
The government suggests that the counsel could have initiated those proceedings, the next business day or whatever, as well as a habeas action.
Right.
So why don't you tell us what your response to that argument is?
Well, a habeas action would have been premature before a removal order was issued.
Well, he was in
why? I mean, it's
because,
always...
Because the claim was that I can't be sent to Syria until October 8th at 4:30 in the morning. He had not been told he was going to be sent to Syria. That was a possibility. That's why they had the interview, but it wasn't
so
a
would have no interest in bringing a habeas claim if he was going back to Zurich or to Canada.
Or to Canada.
He wouldn't have. The courts have held that if you bring a habeas action to challenge your removal before you've been issued a final order of removal, it's not ripe. You haven't exhausted your remedies. You can't
and
do
when
it.
When was
so
he issued that final order?
He was issued it at 4:30 in the morning on October 8th while he was put on the he was being brought to the plane.
Procedurally,
let's assume for the moment that he wasn't blocked from bringing a suit after he was removed. What good would that suit have done him if he had been able to bring it? The order of removal might have been abated through that. And if he had been an alien trying to get into the United States, that would have been very useful. But he wasn't an alien trying to get into the United States. He wasn't trying to get into the United States at all. So what good would it have done him?
Well, precisely, and that's my response to the petition for review, because the government says there's two possibilities. A habeas action while he was here, that would have been premature. A petition for review, they say, technically you can file it within 30 days after you've been issued the order. And usually you have that 30 days to do it because you're sitting in detention while your lawyer is presenting that to the court, and then they can ask for a stay, et cetera. You know the routine. But here, he was denied that. He was then sent off to Syria. That removal order was never served on his counsel. His family did not even learn of his whereabouts until October 21st, 13 days later, when Syria confirmed to Canada that, in fact, he was in Syria. And at that point, there would be nothing that a petition for review could do.
You said a moment ago that Canada was willing to accept him. That seems strange, since it's Canada that told the U.S. government that they had reason to believe that he was al-Qaeda. It turned out, of course, he wasn't. But why would Canada have done that? All they had to do was wait for him to board the plane and come to Canada. He would have been there.
Canada provided erroneous information to the United States. He was a person of interest to an ongoing investigation.
But why do you say that Canada was willing to accept him?
They were willing to accept him. They did not make any suggestion to the United States that they would not accept a citizen of their own country. And in fact,
where in the record does it say that Canada was willing to accept him?
Well, it doesn't say it in the record, Your Honor. It says it in the, if you look at the Canadian Commission report, an 1,100-page report.
Well, that's not in the record.
It's not in the record, Your Honor. I'm not sure it matters, Your Honor, but I think the point is, here you have a Canadian citizen. Here you have a country that doesn't torture, and here you have another country, Syria, that does torture, and we take a man who's simply returning home.
He was willing to go back to Zurich, wasn't he? So it doesn't really matter whether Canada was
All it does is it reinforces the plausibility.
If he had gone back to Zurich, would the United States have had a duty to tell the Swiss that the Canadians think he's Al-Qaeda?
They may well
they
have.
Might.
They may well have.
Would they be able to put him on a plane without telling the captain or the other passengers you're traveling with a person who the Canadians believe is Al-Qaeda? I'm trying to figure out what the U.S. government should have done with Mr. Arar that they could have done without breaching a duty to anybody else.
Well, they could have sent him off to the country of his citizenship and let that country deal with him
Yes, but of course that gets back to whether Canada was willing to accept him.
Well, there's no indication of the record,
Your Honor.
Now,
there's a record. Why was Syria chosen? He didn't have a Syrian passport.
He didn't have a Syrian passport, but he was born in Syria, and so he was technically a Syrian citizen, and so that was an option for the federal government.
And at what point did he tell United States officials that if you send me back to Syria, I'm going to be tortured?
As soon as they asked him, will you go back to Syria?
He was visited at the MDC by Canadian consular official, isn't that true?
That's right.
So if they didn't want him back, would have been the moment to say, take him, he's yours?
Yeah, I mean, they didn't.
Is there anything in the record that indicates that Syria would take him back when they sent him to Syria? That is there anything that when the United States chose to send him via Jordan, I guess, to Syria, or anything about any plane that took him to Syria, did they tell the captain that they were sending him?
It was a private plane.
They could have sent him in a private plane to Canada.
It's not in the record. But if I could address the access to court claim, since we've spent a lot of time on that, and then I'll turn to the torture claim. The access to court claim, Judge Sack, it reinforces the torture claim, to be sure, because as you pointed out in your dissent, this is a whole conspiracy that starts at the point that they detain him and continues after he's been removed, when they are working with the Syrians, providing the Syrians a dossier of questions, getting the tortured answers back from the Syrians.
Where does that come from? Is that in his complaint?
Yes, that's an allegation in the complaint. The dossier of questions was virtually identical to the questions that the FBI had been asking him and the Syrians said on the public record, that they had provided this information to the United States.
Was it the very same officials who told his attorney that he was in New Jersey when he was on his way to Syria, or is it just a case of one hand not knowing what the other is doing?
Well, I don't think that's clear, Your Honor. What's clear is that twice the attorney talked to immigration officials on Monday when she got the voicemail, and twice they told her, you can't see him, he's in transition to New Jersey, when in fact he was there sitting in MDC, and that night they took him off to Syria.
Counsel, you began by saying that this is not a new context, a new Bivens context. Can I ask if you could return to that, since the panel opinion found that it was, and address how we know that it is not?
Right. Well, there's two separate Bivens claims. An access to court claim is a traditional Bivens claim. Christopher versus Harberry holds that you can bring a constitutional damages action or a constitutional damage action for denial of access to court where you plead the claim that you were denied from pursuing, the CAT claim, and you can't pursue it now. The CAT claim we can't pursue now, and we're not pursuing it now, and therefore we have an access to court claim. With respect to torture, Bivens itself was a claim about federal officials abusing a person who they had illegally arrested and searched. Carlson versus Green was a case about federal officials abusing an inmate by failing to provide him with adequate medical treatment. The United States State Department has for over a decade been reporting to the Torture Committee under the Convention Against Torture that federal officials who commit torture are subject to suit under Bivens. So it is absolutely clear that had the federal officials tortured Mr. Arar at JFK, they would be subject to a Bivens suit. It's also absolutely clear that if they had sent him out to a gang in Brooklyn to be tortured, they would be subject to a Bivens suit under the Dwars theory. And it's equally clear that you can't send somebody off to Syria to effect that same unconstitutional end.
Is there any indication that it doesn't apply because he is an alien?
None whatsoever, Your Honor, because it's clear, and the defendants concede, that as an alien present in the United States, he's protected by substantive due process. And if substantive due process protects you from anything, it protects you from torture.
Mr. Cole, as you say, this is a claim for a substantive violation of the Due Process Clause of the Fifth Amendment, right?
Right.
Has any court ever recognized the Bivens cause of action for a substantive due process violation?
Yes, I believe so. Which one
is that?
I can't put my finger on one right here, Your Honor, but we cited to Your Honor.
After all this meticulous work that you've done
on
this case?
I'm sorry, Your Honor, but there are too many cases, but we cite...
Too many that you can't remember one.
Yeah, well, if you look at our brief, Your Honor, we have a footnote that cites a whole series of Second Circuit cases recognizing Bivens claims for abuse inflicted on detainees. That's a Fifth Amendment due process claim.
Is that because the Supreme Court has held that where there is a due process claim, but there is also a more specific claim under which the due process claim must be brought, could be brought, you should bring the more specific claim rather than the general, so that if you have a Fourth Amendment claim, you can't bring the due process claim,
yeah,
and so the Bivens action is then brought in the Fourth Amendment. Or if you have an Eighth Amendment claim, cruel and unusual,
yeah,
you must bring the Bivens action,
yeah,
because you can't make the due process claim.
Right.
But there's nothing that suggests that due process is anything different from these others in terms of being able to sue the federal government for violation.
The only reason
you don't have that case is because in every other case, there is a specific underlying claim. Now, you claim there is a procedural due process claim here, and maybe that trumps it. Isn't that the reason that there is a...
That may well be the reason, Your Honor, but I think in response to Judge Cabrani's question, imagine that the federal officials had tortured Mr. Arar at JFK. Do you really think that any court would say, this is a new Bivens claim, we can't possibly provide relief for torture?
I don't think even the government is suggesting that to you. They acknowledge that torture is illegal. But you started down this line by saying that you were talking about the access to courts claim and the inability to pursue a CAT challenge.
Right.
Did I understand you correctly?
You did, but then I was answering Judge Livingston's question, which asked me to return to the torture claim, which is...
All right, I'm sorry if we've sometimes have you conflating your arguments, but to the extent you're talking about it as an access to courts claim, you do sue a number of people in their individual capacity. What are the facts alleged that suggest that the defendants knew that your client wished to bring a CAT claim such that they then precluded him from doing it? Is it his statement that he would be tortured? Is it something else? What do we look for in the complaint to state that claim, that they denied him?
Right.
What they knew was his desire to pursue a CAT claim.
Right. We have alleged that they intentionally conspired to keep him out of court. What the facts that support that are that he, at every occasion when Syria came up, said, I will be tortured if I go back to Syria. At every occasion, he said, I want to talk to a lawyer. And on top of that, we have defendant's own actions, which on the face of it are inexplicable except by reason of trying to keep the lawyer out of the picture. Why otherwise would you hold this hearing at 9 p.m. on a Sunday night after the lawyer has for the first time come in on a Saturday afternoon? Why would you lie to the lawyer the next day? Why would you then put him on the plane and serve him with his notice while he's going there? There was no reason to hurry here, Your Honor. He was in custody in a maximum security prison. There was no, they could have let the process work its course. And indeed, the Inspector General found that immigration officials typically give foreign nationals an opt time to pursue their claims so that the courts can have a...
I want to ask a rather different question. Are we required by Saucier, in a case of this sort, to decide the existence of the right before we decide whether there is qualified immunity? So let's assume for the moment that a Bivens action is a new action. I know you're arguing that it is not, that everybody should know, and that it is there. But let's assume for the moment that we don't agree with you. Do we have to, under Saucier in this type of case, decide first whether a constitutional right was violated, and only then decide whether these people had qualified immunity, which might be a different question depending on whether if you do something which violates due process, maybe you don't have qualified immunity even if it's a new Bivens, but maybe not. Or can we just go to the question of qualified immunity in this case because the issue of the fundamental right will be tried out in some other context, and so the rationale of Saucier is not there?
Well, as you know, Your Honor, Saucier is up on review. The principle of Saucier is up on review before the Supreme Court.
Yes, but we're deciding now.
But right. You're deciding now, and I read Saucier.
And Saucier is the law at the
yes,
moment.
Yes, and I read Saucier to say that, no, you have to decide the merits first and then the qualified immunity.
But we have said in some cases that that doesn't apply. Judge LaValle and some opinions have said that where there are other opportunities for deciding the existence of a fundamental right, then the reasoning of Saucier is not there and we can move directly to qualified immunity. And what I'm asking is this a case where there would be other opportunities, or is this a case like Saucier, where if you don't decide the fundamental right first, you will never decide the fundamental right because there will always be qualified immunity?
It's hard for me to answer that, Your Honor, because in my view, there is no reasonable argument that there's qualified immunity for keeping someone out of court and for denying him access to the very remedy that Congress provided. That's one. And two, I don't see any reasonable argument that a federal official can torture somebody or outsource that torturing
going
to somebody
back,
else. So
going back to the access to courts claim, you made specific allegations as to what each of the named plaintiffs did.
Right.
And there is no allegation that any of them acted to interfere with access to the courts. Now, the facts and the allegations certainly indicate that there were people who interfered with it. But why wouldn't you just be left with a lawsuit of Arar versus John Doe's when it comes to this claim?
Well, because we have alleged a conspiracy to send this man to torture, an illegal conspiracy, and on top of that, we have put in the record factual allegations that they did everything they could because they knew it was illegal to keep him out of court. That, I think that's all the complaint has to do under Harbor. Harbor didn't apply a heightened pleading standard. It just says you have to put the defendants on notice of what the claim was.
But each defendant who read the statement of what that defendant did would certainly be left with the idea that if anybody interfered with access to the courts, it's alleged that someone else did it.
Unless it was a conspiracy.
Well, but we allege that it was a conspiracy, exactly. And this is a situation. This was not some low-level case, Your Honor, in which we're trying to hold high-level people accountable. This was a purportedly an Al-Qaeda member, which who we had in Brooklyn, whose case required the involvement of the Attorney General and the Commissioner of INS to decide to send him to Syria. It's in which the FBI was communicating with Canada and then with Syria before and after in connection with this. It is inconceivable that these individuals were not involved in the conspiracy to
you didn't,
torture.
I'm not saying it was conceivable or not.
You supplied us with an email, and I'm trying to understand what use we're to make of this. Well, and now the email apparently shows on October 4th at 1 o'clock there was a meeting on a immigration matter involving the Attorney General, Thompson, who's a defendant here, three high, very highly placed FBI officers, and others. Now, is this juror contention that Arar was discussed at this meeting on October 4th?
It is our contention, but the court has, the court of the panel has rejected the filing.
But the panel opinion was vacated by the embargo.
No, I know, but this panel has rejected our submission of that that email. As far that was my understanding.
I want to get an. I'd like to have your understanding.
Have we?
We got an order to that effect from the clerk, right? Yeah, we got an order to that effect from the clerk. I don't know. It didn't say who signed it. But the point, all that does, Judge Parker, all that does is it reinforces what is already clearly plausible on the face of the facts here, which is that this was not some low-level, routine abuse. This was a case that involved the highest levels of the Justice Department and the FBI in a concerted effort to try to get this guy to talk. And when he wouldn't talk here, we decided to send him to Syria to get him to talk through some torture.
Let me ask you about the system that we're talking about. A couple of quick questions. Agents of the U.S. government are authorized to stop aliens at our national borders, such as JFK, when they have reason to believe that these aliens pose a threat to national security. You don't dispute that.
No.
Now, agents of the U.S. government are also authorized to remove from this country aliens who have no legal basis to remain in the United States. You don't dispute that either.
No.
And this removal is accomplished by what we call orders of removal. Is that right?
Right.
Have the federal courts ever allowed a suit for damages, that is, for money damages, to proceed against U.S. officials based on an alien's allegation that after being stopped at the U.S. border and returned to another country pursuant to an order of removal, he was tortured there, or that something else terrible happened to the person? Has there been any recognition of any such?
No, I'm not aware of any case, Your Honor, and I'd say two things about that. First, we're not suing here because he was tortured after he was removed. We're suing because the federal officials intentionally conspired to subject him to torture. Very different, and I think with respect to that, quite clear that a conspiracy to subject someone to torture is unconstitutional.
But there wouldn't be any injury unless he was tortured. There wouldn't be any injury
So
I'm not sure I quite understand the last statement that you're not suing because he was tortured.
Right, we're not. It's not a case in which they made a mistake about a prediction about whether he would be tortured, and he was tortured, and so he came back and said, "Well, you know, you made a mistake. We're suing." It's an intentional conspiracy. And I think that makes a very important difference in terms of the
constitution. So if he was sent to Jordan and the Jordanians said, "My God, this is crazy," and right then and there turned him over to the Canadian consulate, and the Canadian consulate sent him back to Montreal. Yeah. In that case, I take it your position is it would have been the same violation of the same constitutional rights, except without injury.
Well, the damages would be significantly less, exactly.
Okay.
We still would have an access to court claim, right? We still have an access to court claim because they deprived him of his right to go to court. They deprived him of his right to bring the CAT claim in the ordinary removal process that Judge Cabranes was alluding to, an alien would have a right to.
But you're talking, are you not, about a federal suit for damages arising from the consequences of an order of removal? Isn't that what we're talking about
here? No, I don't think so, Your Honor. It happens that this conspiracy to have him tortured was effectuated through exploitation of the immigration power. And so it happens that's the case. It's
an irrelevant fact in your view that he was removed from the United States pursuant to statutory authority to grant or issue orders of removal? You think that's irrelevant?
Well, I think it's, you know, sure, it's a relevant fact, but it doesn't, I don't think it immunizes a conspiracy to subject someone to torture that you went through the motions.
Mr. Cole, Mr. Arar was prepared to be removed, wasn't he?
He was prepared to be removed to Zurich or Canada. He was trying to get home, is what he was trying
but
to do.
But he was willing to go to Zurich as well if they wouldn't send him to Canada.
Well, Zurich is better than Syria. And from Zurich, you can get to Canada without changing planes at JFK.
So he was prepared to be removed. He was prepared to be removed at some point when he realized the fix he was in. He was ready to be removed.
Well, only in this sense, Your Honor, he wasn't seeking to enter the United States, except for purposes of getting to Canada, right?
So it's your position that this removal is just a fiction. This isn't an immigration case. He was just in transit through Kennedy trying to get home.
He wasn't trying to get into the country. That's right. And Your Honor, just imagine they had picked up Mr. Arar on the streets of New York, abducted him, put him on a plane, sent him to Syria to have the Syrians torture him.
That would be a
Bivens claim.
It's your view that the complaint makes out a claim that the removal proceeding is just a cover for which the ultimate goal was sending him to Syria for purposes of intelligence gathering for the United States.
Yeah, absolutely. We allege that.
I need you to help me out a little on that. In the more traditional cases we have of an officer arresting someone without a warrant or whatever, the argument made back to us is there was probable cause or there was a warrant or whatever. And that legal authority immediately becomes the critical issue in the case. So I'm a little hard-pressed to understand why the critical issue is in this case isn't the scope of their removal authority.
Yeah. Well, two things. First, if you had a case in which someone was arrested on a warrant on very strong probable cause and then tortured.
Or on no probable cause, but there's a warrant. I mean, the point is the scope of the legal authority then becomes the defining point for all of the conduct, doesn't it?
But I don't think so, Your Honor, on this example. You arrest somebody legally, you have a warrant, and then you torture him. It doesn't matter that you used a legal process to get him in your hands to torture him. It's still a violation that you tortured him. And the same thing is true.
Well, except that in this case, one's access to the courts has its origins in law that talks about the access given to people in conjunction with removal proceedings.
Right. That's right.
And so to that extent, stick with me. I mean, I'm concerned that it's the authority of removal that becomes the first issue in your claim.
Yeah. Well, I think you have to treat these claims distinctly for purposes of analysis. For the torture claim, I don't think the fact that it was effectuated by removal as opposed to abduction changes the basic constitutional question. Is it constitutional to subject someone to torture? No. With respect to the access to court claim, what matters is that there's a congressional limitation on the removal power. The removal power says you cannot remove somebody to a country where he faces a risk of torture, a risk of torture. A fortiori, you cannot remove someone to a country for the purpose of having him tortured there, particularly when it's probably the most infamous torture country in the world. And so yes, there's a removal authority, but the removal authority was used illegally here because that's exactly the claim that Mr. Arar was never permitted to make, and had he been permitted to make, he might not have had to spend a year in a cell the size of a grave.
Precisely because the concern is that I'll let Judge Sotomayor go.
Sorry, Judge Raji, it's very hard to hear you from that end.
Right. Please, you go.
I'm sorry I interrupted. There is, in my mind, the conflation that you appear to be making with respect to the alleged due process violation of obstructing access to courts generally a procedural due process violation, the measure of damages would be something like getting a new hearing, having a remedy related to the actual violation.
Right.
Instead, what you appear to be doing is saying that there is a Bevin's remedy for money damages for the consequences independent of the actual obstruction to the courts. And that's where I'm having difficulty.
Okay.
I understand your substantive due process argument that there is a right to not have the government conspire to have you tortured anywhere, to hold you physically and have another agent torture you.
Right.
That argument I understand, and I understand why the measure of damages there would be the actual torture, the pain from the torture. But how do you get damages for the torture out of a procedural due process claim related to the obstruction of access to courts?
Okay, you're right to separate those out, and I think one needs to think separately about what the damages would be for a denial of access to courts. Our view is, if he's denied access to courts, there's three possible remedies that he could get. Because remember, the claim is he would have gone to court to say, I can't be sent to Syria because I'll be tortured there. Right? That's the claim he was denied. If so,
he can't do that.
So he couldn't do that.
I mean, you can't undo what happened.
Right. He couldn't do it. So what are the? So let's assume that we prevail on that claim. What would be the appropriate relief? First, I think invalidation of the removal order would be the appropriate relief, because had he been successful, the removal order would have been invalidated then. Second, under
Do you need a Bevin's claim to do that?
No, it wouldn't be.
Do you need a Bevin's monetary?
No, that would damage. Not be, right, you're right. That would not be monetary relief. That would be declaratory injunctive relief, effectively, to remedy the violation that he was unable to obtain because he was denied his right to go to court. But secondly, under Kerry versus Pifus, the Supreme Court has said that when the government denies you a process to which you're entitled, you are also entitled to damages for the emotional distress caused by being denied access to that process. In Kerry versus Pifus, it was just a suspension hearing for juveniles in a school setting, and they said unless you can prove up emotional damages, you get nominal damages, but you at least get nominal damages, and if you can prove up emotional distress, you can get emotional distress. But third, I think if we could show that the consequence of denying him access to court and the consequence of his thereby not being able to obtain the judicial protection that Congress provided was, the foreseeable consequence, was that he was then tortured, I think that the damages for that would also flow. And Bishop versus Tice supports that, a case in which the court said, here's a situation in which Bivens is generally precluded by an alternative employment review scheme, but the defendants denied access to that review scheme. He has a procedural due process claim, and he would get damages for that procedural due process. And if he can show that he would have prevailed in the proceeding that he was denied, he can also get those consequential damages. So I think our access to court claim, Your Honor, gives us potentially all the relief that we're seeking. It could give us the invalidation.
How do we rule? Because what you're suggesting, and I think you've conceded this, is that if we permit a remedy, a Bevin's remedy, for obstruction of access to the courts by even an accidental deportation, which happens with some frequency. Individuals are deported by the INS inadvertently, despite a court order of first stay. You would argue that that removed alien, even if he went to a country where he wasn't tortured, would be entitled to financial recompense. Is that your position?
If he was, well, certainly if he was...
A constitutional violation that he was denied access
to court. If he was intentionally denied access to court, yes. If not, if he was just, he went to court and he lost, which is, but yes, if the INS intentionally takes an alien who Congress has said has a right to go to court to make sure that illegal deportations don't happen, and serve the notice and put him on the plane so that he, and lie to his lawyer so that he can't bring a claim, yes, then he should have that claim. But I don't think you get many cases like that, Your Honor. That's not a floodgates type of situation.
Because most of the plaintiffs or petitioners that Judge Sotomayor is discussing are people seeking entry into this country or are already here. But Mr. Arar was not seeking entry into this country, was he?
He was seeking only for the purpose of transiting to go to
transit visa. That yeah. He wasn't seeking to settle here.
No.
Mr. Cole, we're talking, I think we're agreed, that about a claim that you're asserting for damages arising from Mr. Arar's removal, though I recognize you're saying there's much more to it. I take it would follow from a ruling in Mr. Arar's favor that other aliens who were removed pursuant to the INA may also bring suits against the government for the consequences of their removal.
Your Honor, I don't think so in the sense that what our claim requires the court to hold is that when federal officials intentionally conspire to subject someone to torture, the fact that they happen to use the removal process to effectuate that plan doesn't bar Bivens relief. It wouldn't be to establish some new right of someone who's wrongly removed to bring a damage action.
No, but it would mean that those who are removed pursuant to the INA, who later go back to their country, whether it's Gabon or Honduras or the Seychelles Islands, can assert a claim, as you're asserting here, pursuant to the INA, or rather, asserting a claim for damages, for the consequences of their removal. They could make a similar, no case stands alone. If this case stood alone, it might be of extraordinary consequence, but of course, no case of this consequence is simply a simple case involving only one person. It could involve analogous situations.
Yeah. Your Honor, I hope this case stands alone. But with respect to the...
You think it has no effect on the ability of any other aliens removed pursuant to the INA to bring actions for money damages?
I think a holding that says when federal officials intentionally conspire to subject someone to torture and intentionally conspired him to keep him away from the congressionally mandated judicial review process, he's entitled to damages, not from the consequences of the removal, Your Honor.
I am not sure that this removal can properly be described as pursuant to the INA. Now, I can't say for sure, but I can take judicial notice of a report by the Inspector General, which is highly redacted. And so I don't know what the parts which are redacted say, though I might very well, as a judge having security clearance, want, before I decide anything in this case, to see what the whole thing says. Because this report is very suggestive that what the people did was not proper under the INA, but sending him back to Syria under these circumstances violated the INA totally.
Why?
That he could go back, that in these circumstances, the one thing they couldn't just do is send him to a country of which he did not have a passport, where he did not want to go, when there were other countries that could. So what does it mean to say pursuant to the INA when they are not following
the INA?
And that
goes back to Judge Raji's question. And I would say the most critical fact is that you're not permitted to send someone back to a country where they face a substantial risk of torture. And that's what they did. And so this was, in a sense, an ultra-virus act.
Mr. Cole, this is Judge Sotomayor. You keep saying that. But why do we need, or why do you need to have the obstruction or of access to courts claim as a vehicle at all? If your point starts and ends with the substantive due process claim, that the federal, that no federal agent can conspire with people to torture another human being. Isn't that what you're saying? You can't take anyone on U.S. soil and put them anywhere to torture them. That's just the simple nature of your claim, isn't it?
That's right.
And I think,
why are you asking us to create a Bevin's claims for damages on an INA question of obstruction to access to courts, which without the substantive violation really doesn't have much legs? You're inviting us to say that they're absent the torture claim, mind you.
Yeah.
That in a normal administrative situation, intentionally or not, that we're going to give people Bevin's damages remedies.
Here's what I would say, Your Honor.
When Congress has not chosen to create a private cause of action for a mere, I don't use it lightly, for a violation of an administrative process.
Yeah, it's not a violation of an administrative process, Your Honor. It is precluding an individual in federal custody from getting to federal court.
Let me ask you that because I think that's different from what you argued to us in your brief. In your brief, I understood your concern about the courts to be a response to the government's view that you should not have a Bivens action because you had alternative means of remedying the concern you had. Now you're arguing to us, as Judge Sotomayor suggested, that the Bivens action we should recognize is for a violation of the right of access to the courts. Now, the government relies on 8 U.S.C. Section 1225C12 to argue that when national security concerns are at issue, there's statutory authority for removal without a hearing. So, again, I'm a little confused today as to what the Bivens action is. From your brief, I thought it was to avoid being the subject of a conspiracy to torture, with this question of the courts only being a response to the government's claim that that's why we shouldn't recognize that kind of Bivens action. Help us out.
I think it is confusing because it is relevant to both claims. But if you look at point one of our brief is that he has a Bivens claim for torture and arbitrary detention.
Right.
Point two, and you're right. You're absolutely right, Judge Raji, that the fact that they kept him away from the courts is a response, response, to the alternative remedial scheme.
The point is Bivens action is appropriate here, where defendants blocked access to congressionally authorized judicial review, but not a separate Bivens action.
That's point one. But point two of the brief, Your Honor, is that we have an independent Bivens claim for denial of access to courts under Christopher versus Harbury. The panel dealt with it as an independent claim. We briefed it as an independent claim, and in answer to Judge Sotomayor's question, there were two constitutional violations here. One was to subject this person to torture, and even if they let him go through the courts, if they intentionally conspire to subject him to torture, that's a constitutional violation. But there's another, an equally important constitutional violation, which is that they kept this human being who was in their custody from getting any access to the protection that Congress said people in federal custody should have before they are sent to countries where they face a risk of torture.
Now, Mr. Cole, 18 U.S.C. 2340 makes it a felony to engage in torture or in a conspiracy to commit torture outside the United States. And by the same token, 2340B, I believe it is quite expressed that the felony provisions that I just adverted to don't support private actions. I mean, isn't your substantive due process theory a theory that would, in effect, take the legs out of 2340B?
Well, I don't think it would take the legs out of 2340B. I think 2340 is a criminal statute, and it addresses particular criminal conduct. It doesn't. There's no indication that Congress, in enacting 2340, meant to immunize federal officials who conspire with a person detained in the United States to have him tortured and to have him sent off somewhere to be tortured. It doesn't address that. It addresses when federal officials themselves commit torture abroad. And so I just think it's a different kettle of fish. And I think the reason was there was a concern that there was not any remedy for federal officials committing torture abroad. But with respect to federal officials who commit torture with respect to a person within their custody here in the United States, again, the State Department every year in its reports to the CAT committee has said, if a federal official tortures or is complicit in torture, there is a Bivens remedy. That's what we're seeking. And to Judge Sotomayor and Judge Raji, the access to court claim is not about the failure to provide a hearing. We acknowledge that under 1225C, you can have a removal without an administrative hearing before an immigration judge, but you get, under the INA, judicial review if you file a petition for review. And the government says, you know, he could have filed a petition for review. Our claim is, and as the district court found, it was impossible, and they made it impossible for him to file that claim.
The government's response, just so that we know what your point on this is that it could have been filed even after he left the country.
Right.
And to the extent that he may not have been immediately in Syria or that the court could have pressed the government, given the high levels this was dealt with, to either stop that transfer to Syria or bring him back. What's your response to why that shouldn't have been tried here?
Well, as I said before, what we now know is that he was taken to Jordan, beaten and tortured there, and then the next day taken to Syria. But nobody knew at the time where he was, and it wasn't until
How does that cut in your favor? I mean, that lawyer knew he wasn't in touch with
The last
him.
Our lawyer knew was that he was in New Jersey, that he was in New Jersey. They never told her that he was deported, never told her that he was deported. She learned from the family, who only learned on October 21st, because on October 21st, the Syrians acknowledged to the Canadians that, in fact, Mr. Arar was there. No one knew where Mr. Arar was. In fact, there were theories that he was still here in the United States. So, and no one knew that he'd even had a removal order issued. Because, again, nobody knew where he was except Mr. Arar and the federal government, who did not tell his lawyer.
Okay, Mr. Cole, you've reserved a bit of rebuttal, and I think we're going to wear you out.
And vice versa, probably.
Perhaps.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll hear Mr. Cohn. Yes.
Thank you, and may it please the court. I'm Jonathan Cohn. I represent the United States of America and the former Attorney General, John Ashcroft. Your Honor, we've heard Mr. Cole speak for close to an hour on why he thinks there was a constitutional violation in this case. Even if we agreed with him, and we don't, Your Honors, this is the quintessential case in which special factors counsel against the creation of a Bivens remedy. At bottom, what plaintiff and Mr. Cole are asking this court to do is to recognize a cause of action that Congress did not create, and then to delve headlong.
That's what Bivens action always is.
Correct, Your Honor. And the Supreme Court has admonished time and time again that courts have to exercise caution before extending Bivens.
What are the special factors?
There are several, Your Honors. Let's start with the fact that this case is inextricably intertwined with foreign policy and national security.
If that is so, is it appropriate to consider that at a 12B6 stage, or is it appropriate to consider that later, when we can get a clear statement as to what the State Department, for example, thinks now about allowing such actions without a Bivens action?
Your Honor.
Because it is by no means clear that doing this is in the interest of the diplomacy of the United States. I fly frequently to Italy. I very often stop in France, taking Air France in change. If the French, for some reason, were to pick me up and send me to Syria, for whatever reason, they might well be well advised, and I might. And I think the State Department might just possibly be upset. The question is, where isn't it an aggressive behavior on the part of courts to decide what the policy of the United States is, and therefore keep from acting without knowing what that policy actually is?
Your Honor, to answer your question, it is entirely appropriate to address Bivens special factors and these special factors on a motion to dismiss. Stanley, Chappelle, Shalicki, Molesko.
They can be addressed at a motion to dismiss when we have reason to know what those special factors are without having more information. The problem with this case is that it is a case that involves security, which may cut one way, and it is a case that involves what happens in airports to citizens of other countries, and therefore what might happen in airports to citizens of our country, which involves the interest of the State Department. And as such, it may involve a different play. So the question with respect to that is, when, where? Formalistically, of course, one can take into account special factors at Bivens early, but does it make sense in this case?
Absolutely, Your Honor, because we know there are special factors just by looking at the face of plaintiff's complaint. Let's look at his complaint. His allegations in this case, Your Honor, is that there was concerted action between independent sovereign countries with respect to sensitive counterterror.
That suggests that there are reasons in one direction, but it doesn't cope with the fact that there may be reasons in another direction. I, for one, would be extremely interested to know what the State Department of whatever administration happens to be in power at the time would tell me about whether they think that this would be helpful to have a Bivens action or to hinder such a thing. And I know the things in one direction, but I don't know the things in the other.
And in answering Judge Calabrese's question, let me just add a footnote, and maybe you can incorporate this into your response, and this follows on to something that Mr. Cole said. In May, for example, of 2006, the solicitor of the State Department went to a United Nations meeting in Geneva and told the world that U.S. law provides various avenues for seeking redress, including financial compensation, in cases of torture and other violations of constitutional and statutory rights relevant to the convention, the convention being the Convention Against Torture. And then it discussed some of those, and it went on to say, as Mr. Cole mentioned, that one of them was suing federal officials directly for damages under provisions of the United States Constitution for constitutional torts, and then it cited Bivens. So are we hearing today the position of the Justice Department? Are we hearing today the position of the United States Attorney's Office in Arlington? Are we hearing the State Department's position? Do we have to be concerned with these palpable inconsistencies between the positions in trying to do our work in light of your statement that the resolution of this case is entwined with sensitive foreign policy matters?
Judge Parker, I assure you, the position you're hearing today is the position of the United States. Our brief was reviewed by every agency you mentioned, Your Honor. It's the position.
So then the State Department has backed off from the representations its solicitor made to the world community in May.
Excuse me, I think all these questions are out of order. There are a number of questions that have been presented. Mr. Cohn has had absolutely no opportunity to respond.
Please respond.
So I'm going to ask Mr. Cohn to respond.
Let's hear a response.
Direct questions to be out of order until he's had an opportunity to respond. I don't even know what the question is that's pending, but I have a feeling you do, sir.
I think there might be a few questions, and I'll try to unpackage all these questions and respond to all the questions that Judge Parker and his colleagues asked. To begin with, there's nothing irreconcilable with that statement in the position here. We're not saying as a general matter that Bivens can't apply to torture, Your Honor. What we're saying is in a case like this one, which is inextricably intertwined with foreign policy and national security on the face of the complaint, then this Court should simply wait for Congress to enact a cause of action, Your Honor. At bottom, what this case is about is what plaintiff and his attorney said it's about. It's about separation of powers, Your Honor.
Well, to your knowledge, has Bivens then ever been applied to a case of torture? Let's put this case aside.
To a case of torture, I'm not aware of that, but I can say this for sure, Your Honor. I can say that Bivens has not been applied, first of all, in the removal context, with one exception involving an unpublished decision from a district court case. And the reason why there's a Bivens action there was the government in that case violated a court order on a stay. Putting that one exception aside, there's been no case, and plaintiffs cited no case, in which Bivens has applied even generally to the removal context, even once, much less in a context like this
doesn't contest the removal.
Whether you view it as a challenge to the removal or to something else, at bottom, what this case is about fundamentally is a case that's inextricably intertwined with foreign policy.
Why couldn't those interests be protected under the state secrets doctrine, committed to the sound discretion of the district court as evidentiary issues? Isn't that how we ordinarily do that?
Well, no, Your Honor, a couple things. First of all, the state secrets privilege addresses different issues and has a fundamentally different purpose from Bivens special factors.
It may have a different purpose, but couldn't it handle your foreign policy and security concerns?
No, Your Honor,
for a couple reasons.
First of all, because the mere judicial probing into these issues, irrespective of any disclosure, the mere judicial probing of these issues is fraught with foreign policy concerns. Let's look at Stanley, for instance. The Supreme Court case in Stanley, that case allegedly involved a form of torture, the forcible administration of mind-altering drugs. And what the court said there is, look, there could be evidentiary tools, but that does not matter. The court should still stay its hand and not create a Bivens remedy because the mere judicial probing causes fundamental problems.
Counsel, do I understand you to be backing away from the panel decision, which was that since this is a removal action, there is no jurisdiction, that since this is under the INA, there is no jurisdiction, a whole series of arguments, and saying that what distinguishes this case is that it involves security concerns. That is, if Mr. Arar had been signaled by Canada, or without being signaled by Canada, because there was a claim that he had committed an ordinary crime somewhere, that then a Bivens action might very well lie. And that you're returning really to the position of a district court that which was a very different position from that of the panel, and that was that we cannot proceed with a Bivens action because of the national security concerns that are involved. Is that what that's what you've been arguing, isn't it?
No, Your Honor. We agree wholeheartedly with the panel. We expressly adopted its analysis in our brief. As the panel explained, there are two sets of special factors.
But counsel, you're aware that the panel
Can we get an answer? We have to get an answer. It's just unfair to counsel to just pepper somebody and interrupt them in the middle of an answer to another judge. We have plenty of time.
Okay.
Let's just get an answer. I can't follow the argument.
Your Honor, there are two sets of special factors here. First, the foreign policy and national security concerns that both the panel and the district court identified. This case is fraught with those concerns, and that's one very fundamental reason why simply this court should stay its hand and wait for Congress to create the cause of action. That's all we're saying, Your Honor. It's simply a question of who should make the first move. Is it the courts or is it Congress? And the second point is this, Your Honor. Congress has legislated extensively in the context of torture, as we point out in our brief, and Congress has not created the cause of action that plaintiff seeks, not even after Mr. Arar and his attorney went to Congress and Mr. Cole said, look, there might be some ambiguity in the law here. Please clarify the ambiguity with legislation, and please give my client reparations.
I don't think you're answering me as to what would happen if Mr. Arar had been an ordinary thief rather than, or as in the Kuzam case, somebody accused of murder. The Third Circuit acted in that. I'm just trying to distinguish if what we should be focusing on is the issue of national security here and the intertwining, which raises questions of political question, it raises questions of whether state secrets is enough, it raises questions of whether Bivens is the way, and it raises questions of how do we as a court find out what we should do, because we are activists if we decide for ourselves what is intertwined rather than asking specific information about it from the specific parts of the government that would be interested. If you're instead arguing that the same thing applies regardless of national security, then I'd like to hear that, because I find that a very difficult argument. I was going to say bizarre, but I'm too polite to do that.
Your Honor, a couple of things. First of all, even if this did not concern national security and foreign policy, there would be a question for the court of whether to create a Bivens action. And I go back to the fact that for the last 28 years, the Supreme Court has not extended Bivens once in any direction. For 28 years, the Supreme Court has time and time again rejected Bivens claims and admonished lower courts to use caution. So even if this case was completely divorced of national security and foreign policy concerns, there still would be reason for this court to stay its hand and wait for Congress to create the cause of action, especially after Mr. Arar's attorney went to Congress and said, give my client reparations and give me a...
So what you're saying is that if I was changing planes in France and France decided that I was a thief and took me somewhere, the fact that we had given no Bivens action would be of no concern to the State Department if France started doing that with our citizens in a non-national security case.
Your Honor, I don't know if France did something to you in France and sent
No, they sent me to Syria, which is Judge McLaughlin quite properly.
I don't know why I'd be suing U.S. officials in a Bivens action if that happened, Your Honor. But getting back to the fundamental point here, even if this case was divorced of national security and
You're missing my point. My point is that the State Department might have a very severe, serious interest in not having U.S. citizens be taken out of airports in other countries in situations which do not involve national security and sent off and be tortured, and that therefore the United States might have a very strong interest in creating an action in this country when our people do it to keep people in other countries from doing the same thing. I don't think that's too difficult for
Your Honor,
to understand.
I imagine that the State Department and the rest of the government would be very concerned if France picked you up and sent you to Syria, but that underscores why this is a Bivens special factors case. What you alleged and what plaintiff alleges here is an issue of foreign power versus foreign power. It's for the State Department.
Can I ask a question?
I'm sorry.
Judge Sotomayor, we have a prior question from Judge Pooler.
So this colloquy with Judge Calabresi started with him asking you if you are relying on the opinion of the majority on the circuit panel, because it's my understanding that that opinion was vacated by the en banc.
I'm unaware that it was vacated.
By the en banc vote.
The unbank order did not vacate it, and that means that at any point, for example, if the unbank court decided to dissolve itself, the panel opinion would remain in effect. I mean, the court could vote to do that, but it has not.
Because you were going back, really, to the district court's opinion, who got up to the point of finding a Bivens and then talked about the special factors. That's where you began your discussion.
Your Honor, forgive me if I'm not understanding the distinction, but we agree with both the district court and the panel, and they agreed with each other that this case is fraught.
They don't agree with each other at all, with all due respect.
With respect to the second prong of the special factors analysis, they both concluded.
But not with the use of the INA or other portions of the panel opinion.
And Your Honor, we agree with the panel on that score that that's an independent reason why this court should not create a Bivens remedy. But there's no.
Can I ask a question about the special factors consideration? You don't question the fact that if the appellate's attorney had filed a petition for review of the order of removal as her client was on the way to the airport, that this court would have had jurisdiction to hear that petition?
Absolutely, Your Honor.
Now, does that undercut your concern at all with the need to assess national security, state secrets related information?
Not at all.
Presumably, then we would have had the obligation to do so.
Well, Your Honor, it would be a fundamentally different question. In that case, it would be a record-based query looking at the administrative record to determine whether or not there is substantial evidence supporting the administrative decision. What plaintiff is seeking here is far more. What he's alleging here, Your Honor, is an international conspiracy to torture someone for national security information. And I refer this court respectfully to the D.C. Circuit's decision in Harbury, which in that case the court said, we can't get into that because that raises political questions. Now, we're not asking the court to make that determination, a political question determination, which is a much higher threshold. We're simply saying, Your Honor, with all due respect, that this court should wait for Congress to make the first step. We're invoking Bivens special factors, which is a much lower threshold.
There was a question from Judge Sotomayor.
Counsel, I'd like to go back to Judge Calabresi and try to get your position clear. Are you saying that there should be no Bivens action for any torture by a federal agent?
That is not our position, Your Honor. Well, we're talking about specific.
Right. Now I'd like you to now move along the continuum for me, okay? If a federal agent tortures a U.S. citizen, that's actionable under Bivens.
It's actionable under a statute, isn't it?
It's actionable under statute. That would be criminal, Your Honor. And the question is, there are two questions. One, is there
a Bivens cause of action?
It depends upon the context, Your Honor. Bivens is context specific. And if that issue in this hypothetical were fraught with foreign policy and national security implications, then one should not create a Bivens remedy. But if it's not fraught.
No. Let me. So the minute the executive raises the specter of foreign policy, national security, it is the government's position that that is a license to torture anyone?
No, Your Honor.
A U.S. citizen or a foreign citizen. License meaning that you can do so without any financial consequence. That's your position?
No, that is not our position. That emphatically is not our position, Your Honor. We're saying
so
this.
Why don't we just get the position?
Your Honor, a couple of things. First of all, just focusing on the foreign policy and national security implications of this case and not the other special factors. This case, Your Honor, is not simply a case of the executive coming in and saying there are foreign policy and national security implications. Just look respectfully, Your Honor, at the face of plaintiff's complaint. He is alleging an international conspiracy to torture someone, in his words, for counterterrorism information. He says we invoked Section 235C of the INA, which is about removal of terrorists who pose national security concerns. He's alleging we did not send him to Canada because we determined doing so was prejudicial to U.S. interests. Under the face of his complaint, Your Honor, he is alleging national security and foreign policy concerns. And also, the Supreme Court has said in Hristiadis that any removal of an alien is inextricably intertwined and vitally and intricately interwoven with foreign affairs. And the Supreme Court in Munaf and again in Harbury stressed that foreign policy issues are in the first instance for the political branches. And our point here simply, Your Honor, is not that this court must stay out of this issue completely, but rather should stay its hand and wait for Congress to create the cause of action. Because Bivens fundamentally is antithetical to separation of powers when the context is fraught with foreign policy and national security implications.
But counsel, we look at matters that raise foreign policy considerations every day. Hardly a day goes by that we don't review CAT claims. And the CAT claim is, if I get sent back to this country or that country, I'm going to be tortured. And We look at State Department materials. We look at the litigants' account of what happened to them or their family, and we make judgments. And if we uphold the Kant claim, I mean, by definition, we are sending a unwelcome message to every foreign country in respect to which we approve a Kant claim. And the same kinds of considerations arise on asylum petitions. When we grant asylum petitions, we're making comments in the international arena about how other countries run their affairs.
But, Your Honor, what's fundamentally different?
Help me understand the difference.
Sure, Your Honor. In all those cases you mentioned, there's an express cause of action that Congress created. And our point simply here is this court should wait for an express cause of action that Congress creates.
In other words, you don't like Bivens. You don't like Bivens because Bivens was created by the courts.
And Your
but
Honor,
Bivens is there, and it was created by the Supreme Court. And until otherwise advised, I have to follow the Supreme
I'm
Court.
I'm not sure the Supreme Court likes Bivens either.
It may not, but it is for them to say whether this is too far. Now, specifically, you said something very interesting.
If I may, Your Honor.
May I?
Sure.
You said something very interesting, that Bivens is context-related, okay? That suggests, you just said that deciding when Bivens special factors apply is context related. You gave that as an answer to the question of is everything barred? If it is context related, then the answer you gave earlier that there are Bivens actions which are excluded because of special factors at 12b6 can't be a complete answer. If it is context related, one must decide in the context whether it is appropriate to make the decision at 12b6 or to make the decision later. And that comes back to my question that where there are countervailing special factors, isn't it wiser to wait until later rather than to have the court decide for itself which special factors should apply at 12b6, which is just before anything happens?
Your Honor, I actually have three responses because there are a few questions embedded in there. First of all, it seems like at the core of your concerns and perhaps your colleagues' concerns is you don't have more information. And that might be the result of the fact that the district court did not rule on the state secrets issue, so all the classified declarations are not in the record. And if this court felt that it could not address our Bivens special factors argument at this stage, and I think it can, I'll return to that in a second, but if the court concluded it could not, then I respectfully suggest this court do a limited remand for the district court to review the state secrets issue. The government would have to update the declarations because much time has passed, but allow the government to do that, have the district court rule on the state secrets issues, and then this court could have those declarations before it if it thought it needed to do that. Again, I don't think the court has to do that, and I can get into that and explain why in a moment, Your Honor.
Are there other special considerations here in this case that counsel against our recognition of a Bivens claim?
Absolutely, Your Honor.
What are they?
Well, let's divide them into two categories. First, you have the foreign policy and national security's concern
We've talked about that. I'm not sure you want to go back into that.
I don't think I need to, Your Honor. I think it's pretty clear from the panel's opinion and from our brief.
Yes.
But needless to say, it would cause concerns if this court were to A, inspect intergovernmental communications, B, question the personal credibility of foreign officials, C, probe our relationships with at least three foreign countries, D, assess the national security apparatuses of those countries, and then E, look at and examine the classified information we have on Mr. Arar, which provided the basis of the inadmissibility and terrorism determination.
There's a kind of almost a sadness here. You talk about a limited remand. And the fact that we don't really have any information, the fact of the matter is that you've chosen to challenge this on the basis of what's alleged in the plaintiff's complaint. And therefore, and I frankly think it's just generally unfortunate, therefore we have to accept absolutely everything the plaintiff said, whether it's true or not. If only there were more facts, it might be, in fact,
I suspected more likely than not that all of these terrible things we've been talking about aren't true. That would be in your interest that, in fact, this was, Lord knows, we see these as much as anything, all bureaucratic bungling. Somebody thought the easy thing was that let's just send him to Syria because we can't send him to Canada and we can't send him and send him there, and it was just stupid. They didn't expect them to be tortured. They got assurance. That's all possible. And yet we never get to that because you insist on testing it now rather than having some of the facts. If the facts were known rather than just the complaint, this might this courtroom would be happily empty.
It might be, Your Honor.
May I respectfully interject something so there's no confusion on this? It is not entirely accurate, I think, but you can feel free to correct me. Our panel had these materials available to us. We didn't examine them. These secret materials, which were submitted to us based on the invocation of the state secret doctrine, the reason they were not considered by the panel was the stipulation of the parties that the, and I mean the parties plural, that we could decide this case without reaching the state secret privilege. There should be no mistake about this. We could have done it, and I think probably we could do it. So no one is hiding anything from anyone, and the members of the panel had full access to these materials in a SCIF located in this building and managed by the Department of Justice, to which the members of the panel and indeed the members of this court have had access.
And again, Judge Cabranes, I'm not suggesting the court has to send this case back even for a limited remand for that purpose.
Let me go further, if I may, since we're into the business of providing editorials here. The fact is, if the district court or the court of appeals had decided this case on the basis of the state privileges doctrine, all hell would have been broken loose in this country, and the very people who are now raising the question about the state secrets doctrine would be horrified that we had decided on that basis.
That very well might be true, Judge Cabranes, and we still think this court can resolve this case without looking at the classified declarations or the state secrets privilege. But if this court were to change its mind and decide to either look at the declarations now or to send it back for a limited remand, all I'm saying is that's in the court's discretion.
In your brief, you suggested that if we were to look at the state secrets doctrine, the preferable manner was not for us to decide it, but to send it back. You did say that. You said we could, but that it was certainly preferable for the district court, which had not had a chance to discuss that, to have that before it, together with arguments on the other side. That was in your brief. Do you take that back?
Your Honor, I don't know I use the word preferable, but if we're talking
You didn't say it was impossible. You said it was preferable.
Your Honor, if this court is talking simply about a limited remand, to send this case back simply for the purpose, limited purpose, of the district court examining the state secrets issue first, I think there's a lot of sense to that, Your Honor. But again, our primary position is the court doesn't have to do that, because even putting aside the state secrets privilege and the classified declarations, you still have special factors, counseling hesitation in this case. And Your Honor, you asked me if I oppose Bivens, and that's not our position. That's not the United States' position.
No, I think we can assume that. I think that was probably rhetorical.
Agree, Mr. Cohen, would you not, that it would be better in most cases for courts to decide complicated questions like this on the basis of a record and on the basis of claims that are made by the parties, which are explained to the public in a coherent way, rather than having this done in the proverbial black box by having judges reviewing materials that are secret from the world and then simply announcing, oops, the case is over? That doesn't exactly seem to me to serve the interests of civil liberties in this country.
I agree with you, Judge Cabranes. And again, we think the court can resolve this case based upon the briefing before it. But the reason why I mentioned Bivens.
Can I just ask, in the world where the government can allege foreign policy concerns and terrorism concerns, what role are there for judges at all? Or is this the third rail of the new environment in which judges are cut out of the separation of powers?
Your Honor, we're not suggesting the courts are cut out. When Congress enacts a statute like it has, you got the TVPA, you got FARA, you got 18 U.S.C. 2340A, which imposes criminal liability, there definitely is a role for the courts. But what's being discussed here, Your Honor, is whether the courts should, in addition to those causes of action, create a new cause of action.
It's not a new cause of action. You heard Mr. Cole talk about how we have pledged that we don't torture, and torture is prohibited for the last 20 years. We say it out loud. We signed the CAT Treaty. How could it be a new cause of action?
Your Honor, it's a new context. And
what does that mean, actually?
I'm glad you asked, Your Honor, because it's not simply looking at the amendment. We know that's not the case, because in Davis it was a Fifth Amendment due process claim. But nonetheless, right, in Shalicki and Chappelle, the Supreme Court said it's a new context. We know from cases like Chappelle and Stanley that among the things
that— Well, they were in the armed services, weren't they, or at least Stanley was?
Armed services, Your Honor, but let's look at the analysis there. There are two things they looked at which made it a new context. Number one, it was a context that was generally committed to the political branches, in that case, military affairs, here foreign policy, national security. Second—
So that wouldn't really, that's really distinguishable from this case.
It's the same, exactly. So it's a new context for that reason alone. But there's a second reason why it's a new context. In Chappelle and Stanley, and in this case, Your Honor, you have contexts which have already had significant congressional action. What do we know about this context, Your Honor? First of all, we know that Congress has imposed civil liability on foreign officials who act under color of foreign law. We also know that Congress has imposed criminal liability on U.S. officials who engage in torture abroad. And third, we know that Congress has provided a prospective remedy through the FARA and the INA to challenge a removal order, but not a retrospective remedy for personal monetary damages against U.S. officials in their individual capacity when the basis for those
orders
were
held. You read the retired federal judge's amicus brief. They said we would be creating a legal no man's land were we to believe this argument, and they urge upon us our responsibility to hear this case, to take it up, and to deal with the very issues that you say we can't touch.
And, Your Honor, the retired federal judges are certainly entitled to their views. But let's contrast that with what the Supreme Court has said for the past three decades. The Supreme Court has repeatedly admonished caution before any extension of Bivens is permitted. The last 28 years, all seven Bivens plaintiffs who said extend Bivens have lost. In that time, Your Honor, eight Supreme Court justices have been confirmed, and five have never, not a single time, voted to extend Bivens.
A while ago, you said that there were two groups of special considerations that counsel caution in recognizing or creating a Bivens action in this, what you're calling this new context. And then you talked for a moment and exclusively, really, about the diplomatic and public safety issues. And I'm wondering what that other group is.
The second, Your Honor, is the significant congressional activity in this area, because in addition to the INA, you have the TVPA, you have 18 U.S.C. 2340A.
Oh, then you did actually reach it, because you
spoke. And I did. And just to give, I mean, this could be viewed as a third and bonus reason why this court should not be engaging in the judicial creation of a Bivens remedy, and that is this does involve the immigration context. And with the exception of that one unpublished district court case, which involves a violation of a stay order, plaintiff has not cited a single case.
How does it involve the immigration context? This person does not want to immigrate. I mean, that, I must say, that's the one thing about this case that I just don't understand. I understand the national security interests. I understand all sorts of things that go your way. But what I don't understand is how it is immigration when somebody doesn't want to come here.
I could explain, Your Honor. Judge Calabresi, the answer is this is what Congress said. They defined in 8 U.S.C. 1225C, that's the removal statute that's triggered. That applies to all arriving aliens. And arriving aliens has been defined in 8 CFR 1.1Q to include even the aliens who are passing through. So that's the reason why Mr. Arar, although he did not want to come here,
is there any indication Text is important, but context is more important. Is there any indication whatever that the whole apparatus of immigration law, which is designed to deal with people who want to come in, was intended to deal with somebody who simply wanted to go from one plane to another, which is it's a very different thing. Now, you tell me that this whole thing is there, and you cite that language that is removal. But what I want to know is, do you really believe that in passing the immigration laws, Congress was thinking of this kind of conflict? Is that rational?
Well, first of all, Your Honor, plaintiff has cited no legislative history supporting that view. But second, if that's
I'm not talking about legislative history. Legislative history has plenty of problems. I'm talking about context as against text. When the English courts in the 19th century couldn't cite Hansard, they could cite context all the time.
Your Honor, a couple of things. First of all, I think probably Congress would have wanted the immigration laws to extend to it, because we're talking about an alien who does arrive on our shores and has been determined, pursuant to the INA, to have terrorism connections, and he's hopping on a plane that leaves the United States. I think Congress would have wanted the INA to cover it, and that's why the INA does cover it. But if I'm wrong about that, Your Honor, the answer is for Congress to change the law. And while Congress is at it, of course, Congress could create the cause of action that Mr. Cole asked Congress to make last year before Congress did nothing, and he returned to this court to ask this court to do what Congress chose not to do.
That kind of argument never is very appealing, because one can equally say, if we are wrong, Congress can come in and tell us that we are wrong. You know, if we say that Bivens covers this, Congress can say that we are wrong.
And neither did they prohibit such a course of action.
Let me just follow up on an offer you made before, just thinking about what other kinds of information might be helpful to us. I would like to see an unredacted copy of the Inspector General's report. Can you, would you please supply that to the court?
I can check on that for you, Judge Parker. I can also check to see if the remainder of the classified declarations can be made available.
What do you mean you can check on that?
I'm not the Inspector General.
We have a right as a court to see any material that is relevant and something that is redacted for public distribution. Does not mean that we cannot see it. We all have top security.
I think it's being said that this lawyer does not have the authority to do that. We may have the right to, and I would like to read it myself, but it seems to me that we certainly have a right to be told fairly promptly what the government's position is on that, as well as what the availability is now, or what availability can be fairly promptly arranged for the review of other documents that were available to the panel.
Has your adversary been given an unredacted copy?
Of the OIG report? I don't believe so.
So that would be a question, too, as to whether you would supply it not only to the court, but presumably to your adversary.
As well as what level of security would be, security clearance would be required. For example, whether only the judges could look at it, or only judges and law clerks could look at it, or only judges and law clerks who have a certain level of security clearance. This is not a simple question.
We have had special security clearances for particular law clerks who have worked on these cases. Not all law clerks have been permitted to review materials which are under seal in these cases. Can I ask you a follow-up question concerning Judge Calabresi's line of questions? If I understand his view and the view of others, you're asking us to analyze this case as an immigration case, and we want to know why this should be so. As Judge Calabresi pointed out, Arar was simply changing flights at JFK. How does that constitute attempting to enter the country?
Your Honor, under the definition of arriving alien in Section 235A and the interpretation of that in 8 CFR 1.1Q, arriving alien is defined to include aliens who are passing through. And plaintiff,
so, lo and behold, the immigration laws have something to do not merely with people who simply want to enter the country, but perhaps people that we don't want to enter the country.
Absolutely, Your Honor. And I think
I'm shocked.
I think it makes really good sense, Your Honor, that before we let someone get on another plane after 9/11, we make these security determinations that are made in this case, and if necessary, send the alien to a country that does not prejudice the interests of the United States.
Your adversary says that Canada was prepared to take him. What's your position on that?
Your Honor, this gets into information which I can't discuss with the court, but this does underscore this does underscore precisely why this case is fraught with special factors, because plaintiff's allegation of conspiracy is based upon the assumption that we had no business in redirecting him from Canada to Syria.
All right. Well, I understand. May I just follow up on that one? I understand you're telling us you can't tell us now, but what's your position on whether there's anything in the record before us that speaks to the issue one way or the other?
Well, what plaintiff alleges, and all we have here, in essence, is his complaint. He alleges that he was not sent there, I believe he says, because it was contrary to the interests of the United States.
Right.
But there's nothing
in the— He does not plead that Canada was prepared to take him, so we have nothing on the subject. Is that right?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Is there anything in the record that suggests any consideration given to sending this man to Guantanamo?
Your Honor, that's not in the record, but again, as to what country or what part of the island of Cuba we send him to, that sort of determination, of course, is itself fraught with foreign policy and national security concerns, which underscores simply, again, Your Honor, we're not saying the court has no role in these questions. Our point simply is that before the court gets into these complicated questions, and if the last hour has shown anything, these are complicated questions. Our point simply is, before the court gets into these, it should respectfully just wait for Congress to create the cause of action, as Mr. Cole asked.
The question is Judge Pooler and then Judge Cabranes.
Counsel, as you stand here, you represent the United States of America. Are you certain that the change of administration will maintain this position that you've argued to us?
Your Honor, of course I can't opine as to what the next administration is going to do or say. But, Your Honor, with respect, unless and until there's a change in legal position in this case, unless this court
wants— Well, that's not untypical that new administrations sometimes change legal positions.
Maybe, Your Honor, and again, I'm not going to opine as to what the next administration is going to say or do, but while this case is before the court, respectfully, Your Honor, this court should decide the case based upon the fact that—
But, I mean, you've been telling us that we should wait and see what Congress is going to do. They're one of the actors. But the executive is one of the actors, too. And poor us, we think we're one of the actors, too. But you don't think so. So that's we disagree on that.
That's Judge Cabranes.
To follow up on earlier questions about Canada, does the record show, or even material outside the record show, that the government of Canada has ever stated that it wanted Mr. or would have accepted Mr. Arar back at the time that Mr. Arar was sent eastward?
The record is silent on it. As for what's not in the record, of course, in open court and national
and
television.
As far as you know, the report, this massive report of the Canadian government, doesn't address this issue.
Your Honor, whether or not the Canadian Commission report addresses it, I'm not going to say the United States agrees with it.
There are parts of the Canadian report which are secret. Is that right?
I believe that the report they published, yes. I think they have stuff they've not shown, yes.
Do you know of any case in which a country does not accept back its citizen, somebody who is a citizen? They may jail them when they come, but has it ever occurred in an immigration context, if that's the context you want, that a country of which someone is a citizen, is actually a citizen, can say we don't want that?
It actually happens pretty frequently, Your Honor. And the JAMA case in the Supreme Court a few years ago dealt with that issue because Somalia at that time was not accepting back Mr. JAMA.
Somalia wasn't a country at that time. But there was no government of Somalia.
There's no one accepting him back. And, Your Honor, aside from JAMA, there are many other cases in which the country of citizenship does not welcome back the alien, and that gives rise to a lot of these cases. Like, take Cuba, for instance. Oftentimes they don't accept their nationals back, which gave rise to the Suarez-Martinez case in the Supreme Court.
Well, I think the Zedvitas case, which deals with what happens when no country will accept somebody, surely is dealing with Among those countries would be the country of citizenship or residence.
Yes, Your Honor.
We have yet to hear from counsel from Mr. Thompson. I hope there are no further questions, but I won't stop anybody. Thank you.
I have one virtually clerical question. Mr. Cole seemed to indicate that Arar had not argued in the district court that his denial of access to the court's claim were unrelated to the removal and CAT claims. Do you have a position on that, or do you have a recollection of that?
Absolutely, Your Honor. And I think what this has shown is that Mr. Arar's litigating position has changed significantly. It's evolved from court to court and brief to brief. His access to the court claim in district court had nothing to do with the removal issues. On pages 33 through 36 of his opposition to a motion to dismiss, that's where he discusses access to the court. And not once does he mention CAT. Instead, what he ties it to is detention. And then on page 82 of the supplemental joint appendix, the district court says, I don't interpret your access claim as pertaining to the CAT, but the district court gave Mr. Arar a second chance to amend his complaint. And at that point, what does he do? Does he make it more clear to say that count four, my access claim, covers CAT? No, to the contrary, what he says, he does not amend his complaint at all. And then his motion for 54B certification, what he says on pages 6 to 7 of his brief is, our access claim has nothing to do with removal issues. They're completely independent. And then when he comes to this court.
What's the significance of that?
The significance of that, Your Honor.
Legal consequences?
The significance of that, Your Honor, is this. Going back to the Supreme Court's decision in Harbury, the plaintiff has to allege in his complaint the non-frivolous cause of action that he was forced to give up because of the obstruction. And Mr. Arar did not allege in his complaint he was forced to give up CAT. And in district court, he said, look, I'm not making that argument. It's only once he came to this court, after he was given a second chance to replead, and says, no, I'm not going to replead because the issues are completely different, then he comes to this court and does a 180 and says, you know what, I actually want to change my theory. And it was not just an accident that in district court he didn't link up access with CAT. I assume it was a strategic call because he wanted to keep count four independent of the jurisdictional issues.
And what was that, count four?
Count four is the access claim, and he wanted to keep that. Count four deals only with the circumstances of detention in the United States, and he wanted to keep that separate from the removal issues because those touched upon all the jurisdictional concerns. And that's why he said they're completely separate. Count four does not concern removal, doesn't concern CAT. And then he gets to this court and does the 180 and says, you know what, I want to redesign my access claim to have it touch on these CAT issues, these removal issues. So the first question is, should the court allow him effectively to replead his case now in the Court of Appeals after he chose not to do so in district court? And with respect, I think the answer to that is no, he should not be allowed to do that now. It's unfair to Judge Traeger.
Can I ask one other question about the access claim? I'll defer to Judge Sotomayor.
Okay, we'll hear Judge Sotomayor, then we'll hear Judge Livingston, and then we'll hear the remaining counsel, who's been very patient.
Sorry, Judge Livingston, I didn't hear you. That end of the room is not as clear to me. Counsel, turning to an issue we haven't discussed, which was the TVPA claim, the majority's opinion opined that the only responsibility under the TVPA would exist if the foreign entity exercised control over a federal agent, control and influence over a federal agent. I'm not sure why the reverse is not actionable under the TVPA. If an American federal agent exercises control and influence on the foreign agent under the foreign agent's law, why that isn't equally actionable? Meaning, why does the mirror have to go only one way?
Your Honor.
And what case, I know we have had cases that say that the reverse is true, but that's because the situation there presented that question. Why is the mirror only one way?
Your Honor, this question goes down to the following. What did Congress mean by color of foreign law? And the four judges in this case and the three judges in the district court in D.C. have all concluded that when U.S. officials are acting behind U.S. desks in U.S. government office buildings pursuant to authority under the U.S. Code, they're acting under the color of U.S. law and not color of foreign law.
You're indicating that in this very case, all three judges agreed that Arar had not adequately established federal subject matter, had not stated a claim against the defendants under the TVPA.
That's exactly right, Judge Gabranes, and Judge Traeger reached the same conclusion, and three judges in D.C. reached the same conclusion. So at the very least, even if this court...
That doesn't mean you're right, counsel. Let's go back to my question.
Well, which is why, Your Honor...
I don't mean to jest, because I'm not sure that the view or the lens of this has been turned around. They are using, the allegation here is that the U.S. federal agents, recognizing a more permissive foreign law, contacted an agent in Syria and said, please, under the authority granted to you under your law, torture this person. That's the allegation. Now, I'm not saying it's a truthful one, but that's the allegation. Why is that acting under the authority of American law as opposed to acting under the authority of the foreign law and saying to an agent in that country, use your laws on my behalf and torture this person?
Your Honor, I don't think...
I'm not sure why that doesn't make it acting under foreign law. When, if in fact the allegation is true that the federal agents intentionally procured this torture, not merely acquiesced to it, but intentionally procured it.
Your Honor, a couple things. First, and the reason why, and I'll get to your question in just one second, but the reason why I mentioned that seven judges went the other way is that shows, if for no other reason, Your Honor, that shows why we have to prevail on the second step of qualified immunity, because the law could not be clearly established. But getting back directly to your question, Your Honor, the question is, what did Congress mean by color foreign law? And we can look to a couple sources, one of which is legislative history. And from beginning to end, the legislative history, the House report, the Senate report, the floor statements, are all about targeting foreign nationals who torture abroad. And one of the purposes of the TVPA, we know from the history, was to deter these foreign nationals from coming into the United States. There's not a whiff anywhere in the legislative history about how this statute should apply to U.S. officials who are, even if they are as alleged here, directing foreign officials to torture. There's nothing in the history suggesting that. But also, if you look at, for instance, the Supreme Court's decision in Screws, which interprets color of state law, this comes down to the question of whether, you know, there's the appearance of engaging a law, or is there any sort of sense that someone was using the pretense of the foreign law, in that case state law? And the answer here clearly is no. No one would think that the United States officials here were acting under Syrian law or under the pretense of Syrian law. There's no pretense of anyone here in this country operating under Syrian law, and that's why, even putting aside the history, as a textual matter, one couldn't think the TVPA covers the U.S. officials here. But again, going back to the first response, even if Your Honor were to disagree with me on all this, at the very least, the law is not clearly established, and that's why the U.S. officials, the individual defendants, are entitled to qualified immunity.
I think Judge Livingston had a question, if I'm not
mistaken.
This is
just in brief follow-up to Judge Cabranes' questions about the access to courts claim. I understood your adversary to say that if his client had filed a habeas petition prior to being served with the order of removal, that petition, in his view, would have been dismissed as premature. And I just wanted to ask if you could comment on that.
Absolutely, Judge Livingston. We disagree, and this Court's decision on Michael shows that in extraordinary cases, and no one can dispute that this is an extraordinary case, that plaintiff could have filed a habeas and sought a stay pursuant to the All Writs Act, and plaintiff...
The All Writs Act has been changed since Michael. Michael is a case with Judge
I seem to remember. Jacobs,
and I know very well, and I believe that the All Writs Act was changed in part in response to Michael's to close down what we did in Michael's.
Your Honor, the All Writs Act still...
Put that aside.
All Writs Act still permits the court to protect its jurisdiction, and the All Writs Act could have been invoked. The Real ID Act had not yet been, it could have been invoked, Your Honor. And look, plaintiff and his counsel have relied upon the OIG report, and one thing that's clear from the OIG report is that plaintiff and his attorney both knew on, before he was removed, that this was moving quickly. On October 1st, plaintiff was told he had 5 days to respond to the charges against him. He met with his attorney, and the OIG report says, look, Mr. Arar did not tell his attorney about the 5-day window, and that was the problem. But Mr. Arar knew the issue, the case was moving quickly. He had 5 days to respond to the charges, and he simply did not respond to them.
Counsel, you're referring to Form I-147 that he was handed that told him 5 days?
Yes, Your Honor.
But that form did not include information about Syria, did it?
It did not mention Syria, but
so while it was moving quickly, he had no reason to fear the ultimate movement.
To the contrary, Your Honor, in his own complaint, he alleges that he was afraid he would be sent to Syria.
He was always afraid, and they asked him, the government asked him if he would go voluntarily to Syria, and he rejected that. But when they handed him the form I-147, they did not tell him that Syria was still a live consideration. Did they?
They did not. According to the complaint, they did not tell him, but he still had that concern, and he could have done something. The trouble was, according to the report on which he relies, the OIG report, he just didn't tell his attorney about the 5-day window. But, Your Honor, even putting
and
that aside.
The next notice she got was Sunday night.
What would the allegation be in habeas? There would be no basis for alleging that he's about to be sent to Syria where he fears torture. I mean, what would the petition say? Wouldn't a judge looking at it say, come back to me when you have a basis for seeking habeas relief? Because indeed, he wanted to leave.
Your Honor, I'm not going to speak for what a judge might or might not have said, but in his habeas petition and his petition for a stay, he could say, look, things are moving quickly. I'm afraid they're going to send me to Syria. Don't let that happen. But, Your Honor, this is not the first question the court should be asking with respect to the access claim. And it's not the second, third, fourth, or fifth question the court should be asking with respect to the access claim, because there are many, many reasons why the access claim fails, the first of which is he just didn't properly plead it. Under Christopher versus Harbury, he has not made an access
that
claim.
That was the question that Judge Livingston asked. This other part you've talked about for quite a bit of time. Judge Livingston asked the question with respect to whether the habeas claim could be brought. And as to that, I'm not sure that we have yet an answer. You may win on any number of other grounds, but if that's the question, answer it.
Well, I think I did, Judge Calabresi. My answer is consistent with Michael's. He could have filed a habeas petition and a motion under the All Writs Act for this court to preserve its jurisdiction. But if this court disagrees with me on that, Your Honor, my point simply is, and that is my answer to that question, but if the court disagrees on that score, my point simply is there are at least 5 other reasons why this court should still reject the access claim.
Thank you very much.
And there's another claim here with respect to his treatment while held in the United States. To the extent that habeas is an equitable remedy, he could have filed with respect to his treatment here in the United States and his concern that that was going to then escalate to moving him to a country where he could be tortured, right?
And that's correct, Judge Raji.
The court would sort it all out, but that whole concern would have been raised.
That's right, Judge Raji. He could have done that. And he...
Thank you. Okay. We'll hear counsel from Mr. Thompson. Thank you.
Thank you, and may it please the court. I'm Jeff Lampkin. I will be speaking on behalf of all the individual defendants, although I represent Larry Thompson.
You represent Larry Thompson, the former Deputy Attorney General?
Former Deputy Attorney General, that's correct. And I'll be addressing issues for all the individual defendants, in particular the question of qualified immunity.
Even though you don't represent them?
Yes, we've asked, rather than have the court have every one of the individual defendants parade up here with their own lawyers, they've elected one, and I have had the honor of being here.
And I approved that arrangement.
I should emphasize at the outset, however, I will hopefully we can keep this mercifully brief. I should emphasize at the outset that none of the individual defendants condones torture. A conspiracy to have somebody tortured abroad is a criminal violation of federal law and morally wrong. But qualified immunity must be granted unless the complaint establishes a violation of clearly established constitutional rights established at the time the officers acted. With respect to counts 2 and 3, it was not clearly established in 2002 that the Fifth Amendment applies extraterritorially to aliens, unadmitted aliens, that it protects a Canadian-Syrian dual national against torture in Syria. In fact, cases like Eisentrager, Verdugo-Urquidez, Harbury, Rasul versus Meyer. Hello? I'm sorry?
Wasn't us.
I don't know what has happened.
Oh, okay.
But we are, this is an electronic courtroom, which is okay. A wonderful right. Achievement.
I thought there was a case, I was in such a long list, I thought there was a case I left out called Test, and I hadn't heard of it.
We were not making noises.
Well, I think it was, and Wanwu and Linus were the last of that list, so we'll stop it there. If the Supreme Court in Verdugo-Urquidez said, we have rejected the claim that aliens are entitled to Fifth Amendment rights outside the sovereign territory of the United States.
The claim that they are making that they conspired in the United States to have them tortured outside. That is, isn't the claim that they are making at 12b-6 that your clients turned them over to other people so that they could do that, so that it is like Price and the cases in which people did not actually torture, but committed the act.
I think I understand the question, notwithstanding the interruption. I think that case, that is answered by the D.C. Circuit's decision in Harbury. In Harbury, it was precisely the same claim.
The D.C. Circuit doesn't answer our question.
Of course, but for purposes of determining what a reasonable officer could have thought the law was, if the good judges of the D.C. Circuit unanimously come to a particular conclusion in Harbury, I think it would follow a fortiori that a reasonable officer can come to the same conclusion. But what Harbury says is that when you're determining the territorial reach of the Fifth Amendment, you look to the primary constitutionally relevant conduct. In that case, it was torture, and it was alleged to be torture that was the result of a conspiracy in the United States.
But the conduct here, again, is the conspiracy to hand over to torture. That's the conduct which they are claiming. Now, are you saying that it wasn't established? You might be, that it wasn't established until maybe Boumediene established it, although I'm not sure, that a conspiracy to turn somebody over to torture, just like actual torture, would violate the Constitution.
And the answer is it certainly was because of the territorial limits on the Fifth Amendment protections against torture. If the torture abroad didn't violate the Constitution, a conspiracy to do something that doesn't violate the Constitution would not either. And in terms of handing somebody over, I have to go to the next line of cases, which was in Wanwu and Linus. And in both of those cases, the claim was that it would violate substantive due process to hand the individual over to a foreign country, in Linus to the former Soviet Union, and in Wanwu to Nigeria, because in Linus's case, he thought he was going to be executed without due process of law, killed. In Wanwu, because he thought he would be tortured by the Nigerian military because of things the United States had done with respect to Nwanwu in the United States. And in each case, in Linus, this court said it does not state a claim because the Fifth Amendment does not apply extraterritorially.
But,
and in Wanwu,
to go back to letter.
Okay.
No, please.
In both those cases, there was no allegation that the U.S. had asked those foreign countries to undertake the activities that they intended to undertake. In those cases, the allegation was that the U.S. had acted knowing those states would do that, but not that the U.S. had procured that activity. Isn't that a very substantial difference?
But for Harbury,
nothing in those cases.
Well, in Harbury, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
In Harbury, the allegation was precisely that, that paid CIA assets in Guatemala as a result of a conspiracy in the United States kidnapped, tortured, and murdered Jennifer Harbury's husband, who was an alien abroad. And the D.C. Circuit held the Fifth Amendment does not reach aliens abroad, and for that reason, there is no constitutional violation. And in Linus and in Wanwu, yes,
but
indeed,
it was
knowledge.
He wasn't right. Here. The husband wasn't in the United States, physically in the possession of U.S. agents.
That's correct.
Turned over to someone at the alleged request of the U.S. agents for the specific purpose of torturing that husband.
Correct.
The issue there was whether that husband, who was in the physical control of another person outside the U.S., whether that agreement could reach that activity outside the U.S. That's very different than someone who's physically here in the U.S. removed for purposes of torture.
Those are differences, and I would not deny that the court could navigate among these cases and come to the conclusion that, yes, it violates the Constitution.
You're saying essentially that there are no cases that support, and for qualified immunity, it's not enough that you can distinguish the other case.
That's exactly right. It's not enough for plaintiffs to prevail to say that they can distinguish all of our cases. What they need to show is that any reasonable, the notice was so clear, so unmistakable, that any reasonable officer confronting the situation would know that the Constitution prescribes the torture abroad or the removal of a person for the purpose of torture abroad.
So your theory is what went through these people's minds was that, well, maybe the Constitution doesn't permit that, but what was their reflection when they were looking at Title 18 of the U.S. Code? How could any American, particularly a high government official, not know that based on the allegations in this complaint, what they were doing was patently illegal?
Certainly a violation of criminal law, certainly grossly immoral. But the Supreme Court has already, in Davis versus Sherrow, told us that the fact that it's illegal under other law or otherwise wrongful, even if it clearly violates the statute, does not alter the qualified immunity analysis under the Constitution. It has to be clearly unlawful, clearly a violation of this cause of action, the source of law.
Are you saying that the facts alleged would state a violation of criminal law?
Yes, I believe that the facts alleged would be a violation of law because there's a conspiracy.
If some criminal laws may implicate the Constitution and some may not. Do you think that a prohibition against torture implicates the Constitution or not?
I'm not sure I follow the question, but I don't think the fact that Congress has that the elected branches have exercised their authority to prescribe certain conduct would necessarily mean that prescription is then imported into the Constitution.
You think that a reasonable person who knew that what he was doing was violating a statute against torture would think that would not implicate a violation of the Constitution?
I think anybody who had read Verdugo or Quidas would have come to precisely the opposite conclusion, which is to say Congress can prescribe these things, but the Fifth Amendment itself is not extraterritorial. And I think that if I go back to Nwanwu for just a moment, in Nwanwu, the reasoning speaks way beyond the facts, because the First Circuit said, not only does this not violate knowingly deporting this person to Nigeria where he's going to be subject to torture, not only does it not violate substantive due process, but that type of allegation does not state a claim for a constitutional violation on any set of facts.
One thing clear to me, because I frankly don't know it. I know that the violation of a state law does not, under Supreme Court decisions, they're odd, but they're there, mean that there isn't qualified immunity for a violation of something which is federal.
That's correct. That is Davis versus Sherrow.
Yes. But I didn't know that the Supreme Court had said the same thing among federal laws. That is, I had read Davis, as you have just described it now, which is understandable because it's a different sovereign, to say that though you might violate state law, that doesn't deprive you, you did a crime, but that doesn't deprive you of qualified immunity federally. You are now saying that if you violate a federal law, you still may have qualified immunity with respect to another federal? That's a rather different claim, isn't it?
The answer is absolutely. That's what I'm saying. Absolutely.
Because
that's what the D.C. Circuit
applies to constitutional violations.
Exactly, and absolutely. That's what the D.C. Circuit concluded in Harbury, and absolutely. That's what Davis versus Sheriff says. It says neither federal nor state officials lose their immunity by violating the clear command of a statute or regulation, unless that statute or regulation provides the basis for the cause of action sued upon. That could not be clearer.
Well, why don't you following up on Judge Raji's question? Why? If torture is universally condemned, as I think we would agree, by civilized nations, as contrary to the evolving standards of decency that mark the progress of a maturing society, it surely must be barred by the Constitution.
On the contrary, Your Honor, the Constitution has a territorial scope. And in case after case, from Eisentrager, Verdugo-Urquidez, Harbury, Linus, the courts have said the territorial scope is the sovereign territory of the United States.
But the argument has been made, and it's a very strong one, although a controversial usage, that the government's alleged conduct is a form of outsourcing of torture. And going back to the question Judge Calabresi asked and others, if the action is taking place in the United States to achieve torture abroad, I don't understand why this really implicates this concern about extraterritoriality.
Well, certainly, Your Honor, the conspiracy in the United States would be something that Congress could reach, and that is something that Congress has reached through criminal law. But if the conduct abroad isn't unconstitutional, a conspiracy to do it here can't make that conduct abroad unconstitutional. And it's for that reason that the conspiracy itself is not a substantive offense. It's merely a means of holding people liable for a wrong that is committed by others. And for that reason, even, you know, and the bottom line on this is that, you know, at the end of this proceeding, the court rules that people can't export torture, that it's unconstitutional to do so. That would be a fine ruling. But the court would also, to deny qualified immunity, have to say, notwithstanding every court having addressed this time and time again, saying, you know, if it's extraterritorial, even if it's planned here, it doesn't violate the Constitution. The court would have to say, even though every court that's reached it has said the Constitution doesn't address this issue, any reasonable officer must have known that, in fact, the law was to the contrary. And that's just not a tenable conclusion.
Okay. Thank you. You're running over.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your indulgence.
Before we hear from you, Mr. Cole, I don't think I ascertained, Mr. Cohn, when you might be able to get back to us conveniently with a letter, with a CC to your adversary concerning when an unredacted copy of the report, or whether it could be made available, and if so, when and under what circumstances.
Would a week be sufficient for the court?
Yes.
Okay.
You'll do it by fax with a copy to your adversary, and the fax would go to the clerk of court.
The portion of the adversary, I can't commit, Your Honor, that we can give classified.
You would not be providing a copy of anything to anybody. You would simply be telling us whether you are able to make available, what you can make available, in what form, and when, and whether you can make it available to your adversary, and what the security level would be. For all I know, your adversary has the requisite security level. I just don't know.
When you let us know, we will then let you know what it is that you should do, because we might not want to see it if you can't give it to your adversary.
We need more data, as everyone, I think, has said. So if 1 week is convenient, then you'll fax a letter with a CC to your adversary, not containing anything that could arguably be deemed to be subject to secrecy, but simply saying what the arrangements would be.
Yes.
And this report was made available to Congress, is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yeah. May I suggest, Chief Judge, that in that material, if you have a view as to whether, if you take the view that defense counsel are not able to review this for whatever reason, I think it's important that we have an explanation from you as to why one would adopt such a position and what the authority might be for showing material to the court only.
We will include that in our response, Your Honor.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Cole, we'll hear you for, you have 5 minutes rebuttal, but please don't feel compelled to use the whole time.
Yeah,
That's a hint to us.
Now you know why this is. Now you know why the Supreme Court has a half-hour time. Let me start with the question about Canada. The record, in fact, reflects that Canada told the FBI that they would have no basis for declining his entry because he is a citizen, and told that they, and also said that they'd be happy to keep him under surveillance when he came into the into Canada. And that's in the record, and I think the public record would show that Canada, that would help, wouldn't it? A193.
Thank you.
And I think the public record would also show that Canadian law, like U.S. law, does not allow a country to keep out its own citizen. As to that, I think Mr. Cohn was simply wrong in saying that there's nothing in the record, and I think on the face of it, the assumption has to be a citizen gets to go back to his country. In addition, the consular officer who met with him on October 3rd said, "Oh no, you won't be sent back to Syria because you're a Canadian. You'll come back to us." So I don't. That's just with respect to that. I want
I
to talk
he
about.
He assured him that he would not go to Syria. I don't think he there's anything in the record. That on that occasion he said, "You'll come back," or "You'll
come back."
No, but
she said, "Because you're a Canadian," so you know that would be
well,
the implication. And again, the record says that he could go back to Canada. So that which raises the question that started this case: why in the world would the United States send someone who is Canadian, who had every right to go back to Canada, to Syria instead? And I think further, why would they, if they thought what they were doing was lawful, why would they short circuit his every possibility to get into court? I want to talk briefly about the special factors that Mr. Cohn talked about the access to court claim, just to respond to some claims he made that I think are false, and then finally a word on qualified immunity. With respect to special factors, as Judge Livingston pointed out in her question, there is no question that had they not blocked him from going to court, he would be able to litigate his concern about being sent to Syria because he would be tortured there in this court, in the Court of Appeals. If it's justiciable then, it's justiciable now. He'd be able to put forward any evidence that would support a risk of torture, which might include the federal government has conspired to send me there so that I'll be tortured. It might have included Canada will accept me.
There would be a petition for review, but what would we be reviewing? There would be no administrative record. There would be no IJ's hearing. There would be none of the materials that we normally have.
Right. That's right. And and I think that would require the court to come up with a solution to that problem, as the Third Circuit did in Kuzam, where similarly there was no record below, and so it remanded it to the BIA to provide an opportunity for a record to be developed. The problem with 235C summary exclusion procedures is that there is no hearing, so you'd have to create some opportunity. But it's clear that any alien who claims that he faces a risk of torture in a foreign country can come into court, file a petition for review, and put on any evidence, and the court can consider any evidence that would support that.
Is that even if he's being removed under 235C,
yeah,
he still has the CAT rights?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And in fact, the government conceded that in its argument that was our exclusive avenue of review. If we didn't have that avenue of review, it obviously wouldn't be an exclusive avenue.
Although he doesn't seek admission, do you concede or do you agree that this was a removal?
Do I concede that? Well, it was formally.
Was this a removal or was this something else?
Well, I think it was, as I've said.
In terms of the statutory definitions, not your own personal inclination, but
yeah,
your professional assessment, is this a removal?
It was. They used the removal authority to effectuate.
Well, do you think that's legitimate? You've read the statutes. You've lived with this case for years. Tell me now. It's very simple. Do you think that this was a removal, or within the definitions of what constitutes a removal?
It was a patently illegal removal, but it was a removal.
So let me ask you. I live in Western New York. A fellow walks across the Peace Bridge, and he's a member of Al Qaeda, and the immigration officer looks at him and says, "Go back to Canada." Does the immigration officer have the authority to do that under the statute, or does he have to do something else?
If the person says he has a fear of being tortured,
he comes to the Peace Bridge. They come all the time.
Yeah,
and he comes up on a hit list for an Al Qaeda sympathizer, and the immigration official says, "Go back to Canada." Does he have the authority to push him back?
That's
to Canada?
Right. He certainly does. But if the alien said, "And I have reason to believe that I'll be tortured in Canada," then he doesn't have the right to send him back without a process.
Okay, fair enough. That's
what that begins to sound as if you're urging us to recognize some right or some entitlement to a period of time between the decision as to where to send the person and the execution of that decision so that there can be a CAT claim brought. Do I understand that correctly?
Well, I think that I don't think one needs to establish, I think one needs to establish, I think, yes, that the alien must be provided an opportunity to pursue judicial review, and if the government has taken every step it can to make sure he can't, which includes, includes the immediate removal, but also includes the keeping him from his lawyer, and then as soon as he has his lawyer, have the.
But you say it does include immediate removal. So I take it the simple answer to Judge Wesley's question is that a person who comes over the Peace Bridge says, "I'm Al Qaeda and I'm here to do harm." The INS agent has no, the ICE agent has no authority to say, "Go back."
No, he has authority to go back, but then.
Right then and there. But you're saying he has authority to say that, but then the person who has walked over the Peace Bridge has the right to start a proceedings in the United States.
If he faces a threat of torture, absolutely.
He can make that claim. I think that's what we were discussing earlier. He can make the claim and seek damages. And he would, and the person crossing the Peace Bridge in Judge Wesley's hypothetical would be one of the 320,000 people who every year, on average, are removed from the United States pursuant to orders of removal of the kind that Judge Jacobs was just saying. And in connection with the average over the last decade have been 1 million who were simply returned at the border, which is really what we're talking about. I mean, there you don't even have orders of removal. You have immigration officers who take this putative person, this person who walks across the bridge, and puts him right back on the bridge and says, "See you."
Yeah.
We do that over 1 million times a year.
Yeah.
But you're telling us that in these circumstances, though every one of them has the potential to file a lawsuit in a United States District Court for damages.
No, I'm not saying that at all, Your Honor. What I'm saying is that if...
I'm not suggesting that each of them, credibly would succeed or that there are that many...
Not even potentially.
All right.
Not even potentially.
Why is Arar's claim different from all other claims?
Because Arar's claim is different from all other claims because he has alleged that federal officials intentionally conspired to subject him to torture and use this ruse illegally in contravention of the law and without the and keeping the courts out of it to achieve that illegal end. That's not a claim.
Do you need even to admit that much? Even if he said that the people at the Peace Bridge had that same aim and sent him back, which I think they perfectly and patently could, this is a different case. They didn't send him back at the Peace Bridge. They took him, they said to New Jersey, which is pretty dreadful, they took him somewhere in order to torture him. So that's a very different case from the million cases that Judge Cabranes is quite proud of.
Absolutely. And in addition, Judge Cabranes, the millions of people who come across the...
They can make the claim that if they're sent back to El Salvador, which can be a very unpleasant place for many people, many Salvadorans who have come to this country, that they can certainly make the claim that somebody in El Paso conspired to send them back and be tortured in El Salvador.
right? That's right. And if they do, Your Honor, there is a process which Congress has provided which requires that they be given an opportunity to make that case and to seek judicial review if they're wrongly denied. So the fact of the matter is that the millions who come in from Canada don't claim that they're going to be tortured if they're sent back to Canada or from Mexico, and there's no issue.
Are you making a distinction between somebody? I understand you are saying that this claim exists, even for the person who is stopped at the border and who makes that claim. Are you making a distinction between that claim and between that and the person who wants to go back over the bridge, who is taken from going back over the bridge, who is brought to New Jersey, and there the conspiracy? That is, if we uphold your claim, why on earth should we say, hint, suggest, do anything to indicate that the person who will be sent back over the bridge, even if he alleges torture, would have a cause of action? Why on earth would we? It's not this case.
Well, that's right. And I think the key is, you know, the plausibility threshold.
It's the next case.
No, it is, but it isn't the next case, Judge Carbonas, because there has to be a plausible allegation. And
plausible. Very good word.
And this
Iqbal
case,
against Hasty.
And this case, under any standards of pleading, absolutely says, I mean, no one has ever been able, from the government side, has never been able to come forward and give any reason, other than we wanted him locked up and tortured, to send him to Syria rather than to Canada.
Before we get into the question of deportation to New Jersey, I'm going to just thank all counsel for expert argument, and we'll reserve a decision, and at this time we'll adjourn court.
Thank you.
The Second Circuit Court of Appeals has not issued a ruling in this case. You can watch this oral argument again or other recent America and the Courts programs at cspan.org. Just click on America and the Courts under the C-SPAN series link. And join us next week for America and the Courts, Saturday evenings at 7 Eastern on C-SPAN.
Hi, I'm Delia Rios, history producer for programs like the White House and the Abraham Lincoln Bicentennial. I want to suggest the perfect gift for the historian